you go on your first plane flight and it's a really shitty day in Sydney and it's grey and it's raining, and as soon as you get above the clouds then it's always sunny, it's always happy, it's always light, it's always above the clouds. I've just been doing the inner city thing seriously hard for, you know, 10 years or something, and had had a hell of a lot of fun and had just sort of lived that life to, you know, about as far as you can take it. And I ended up having this kind of disaster where my studio caught on fire one night and I kind of burnt the house down and kind of got evicted and had to, like, leave.
Essentially, you're just particles in space, brain chemicals etched into your face. You know, they come and go, they suck and blow. It's just kind of like, it's hard not to feel pretty insignificant when you've got that to look at.
And it's almost as if moving here is just getting up above the stuff that's holding you down. And that to me is the common thread of the album. That's why I named it that. It's just rising above whatever's going on in your life that's holding you down.
How did I first get into making music? When I was at school, it was like, it was the only thing I ever wanted to do in my life. It was like, you know, that or being a train driver, but it was kind of like my first, like, sort of mucking around band, like, playing in a rock band with an electric piano going through a distortion pedal. Playing like AC/DC and stuff. I discovered Kraftwerk and Severed Heads and SPK, strange electronic music. Got a drum machine, started sequencing up everything, then we moved to backing tapes and it sort of just like suddenly went really techno. And then that sort of morphed into my next band, which was The Lab. It was a little bit arty and sort of, but dance-based and song-based. And then I met Andy Ratson and we started off Itchy and Scratchy. More instrumental, totally. It was more just techno, because he was far more into techno than I was. I was just into sort of electronics in general. It was good. It was like having them both meant you could just explore different areas with different people, and I was kind of in the fortunate position of, like, when people ask me to do remixes, I could give them a Paul Mac mix. There was never any, oh, can we have a house mix, can we have a big beat mix, can we have it in this style, thanks. It was just, can you do what you do? I sort of Zelig-like, depending on what person I was with, was what sort of music I wrote, and that's still the case now. You know, if I'm with, you know, a DJ, suddenly I'm more housey. You know, if I'm with Andy, then suddenly I'm more abstract. When I'm with Daniel doing I Can't Believe It's Not Rock, then I rock out more. Just kind of like go with the person that's in the room.
Album, it's like when you're just chilling and just, you know, in a nice place and you're just feeling that nice vibe. It's more that sort of album to me. I think it's, you know, like after the party and you've had the intense experience and now it's time to kind of recollect and just feel different stuff about it and just feel a warmth and feel, you know, nice and funky and laid back. It's not so aggro and banging, it's more just like dreamy and warm and feeling. Face scarred, lungs tarred, you're never wrong, knew all along, it's just the alignment of the stars. Him, shade, so say, the answers came, more of the same, until they fell away, cause when it comes to dying, I'm not frightened. Love Abby Dobson's voice, you know, I just think she's just, you know, such
such a great singer.
On the double, yeah. I love that. I fucking love that.
I just done a couple of remixes for Leonardo's Bride.
Different every like
Leonardo's stuff has a certain real mood about it. And so a couple of my songs kind of, I thought, had that mood as well. And thought, well, Abby might be good for those. From Single Gun Theory. We were label mates, you know, Itchy and Scratchy and Single Gun Theory are on the same label, but I've always just loved her voice. The breathy thing that she's got and the kind of Indian melody thing that she's got. Peter, I suppose, was the real discovery because she actually lived up here, and we used to just like, I used to see her up the pub all the time, just hanging around with a sort of bunch of friends, and I knew she could sing. And we sort of started to click as to what we both liked and where we could take it. And then doing backing harmonies and she's the aggro one. She's the one who can do the sort of energy and just sort of, you know, fuck you tracks a bit. Tex was the only vocal that wasn't recorded up here because just he was touring and it was impossible to get him, and it was cool. He sort of rang me up and said, yeah, let's do the song. A few beers each. You know, he nailed it. He knew what the lyrics were about. He got it. He just sort of got it straight away. And he was the heat-seeking pleasure machine. And then, so he nailed the vocal, which was really nice. And we had bulk fun doing it because it was just like, yeah, let's rock. And I just sort of went, look, Tex, I need to scream. Can you give me like a really big scream? And he just sort of looks at me as only Tex can and sort of goes, yeah, I can do scream. Wow! Another one? I need some! Just gave me like a minute of screaming, which was just perfect. I can just like cut that up and lay it together and just build this kind of explosion, which is, you know, what it's about after all. It's just like racing through the night. Yeah! You know, so it was like, he was the man for the job. Getting to know the Silverchair Boys, it was cool. It's been so much fun just playing like with Ben and Chris. You know, imagine Australia's fucking best rhythm section rocking along and I'm on piano. Since I met Silverchair, it was like when I go to their concerts, I'm dancing at their concerts. I'm like, I find them really funky because they do that really slow kind of stoner zeppy kind of groove, and that's what I pick up on in their music mainly, is actually the groove. You can't ask for a better rhythm section. And then when I got all the songs together and looked at it, it was almost like a week in the life. There was like, here I am living at home above the clouds, then I go out, and then I meet someone, and then I get dumped, and then you know, I ask them to stay, and then, you know, I get really cosmic because I'm depressed, and then, you know, I go raving, and that doesn't work for me. And then the final kind of, like, turn of the circle, sort of where I was at the end of the album, you know, I'd sort of, like, I had the fireplace going, I was just sitting alone, and I think it sort of captured what I was trying to express.